Hey there, Mr. Reddit here. Welcome back to another episode of r/Entitled Parent Stories. Our first story we'll be reading today, Entitled Coworker Becomes an Entitled Parent. After that, Entitled Roommate Has No Idea I Left. And after that, Karen Demands I Load Her Dresser Because I'm Parked Next to Her. Now for every thumbs up this video gets, one Karen has to load her own dresser.
Like heck I will.
So please smash that like button. And if you're new, subscribe and turn on notifications for new stories from Reddit every single day. Entitled Coworker Becomes an Entitled Parent. This happened slash started about a year and a half ago. Entitled mom shows up at my desk one day at work. I've seen her at meetings, but never interacted directly with her. We work in different parts of the building for different functions. She's in customer service and I'm in supply chain. I'm several steps up the food chain and I don't know her name. Entitled mom.
Are you?
Says my name. Me, checking to see if my desk name place card disappeared. Yes?
Okay, I heard you used to be in the military.
Not a question, just a statement. Me, yes, I was.
Okay, I heard you used to fix electronics. Is that true?
Me, I did. I haven't done any of that work in about 10 years.
Okay, but do you still know a lot about electronics?
Me, not liking this conversation. Some things, yes, some things, no.
But you could add a printer though, right?
Me. I'm sorry, I have a meeting to go to in a few minutes. What do you want?
Well, I need you to add a printer on my computer.
Me. You know the step-by-step directions with screenshots are posted over all of the printers, right? And isn't IT right next to where you work? They can help if you need it.
It would take you only a minute. I'm horrible at this kind of stuff, and IT is off-site today.
Me. Okay. Which printer do you want to add? Entitled mom looks at me like I'm stupid.
The one closest to my desk.
Me. Yeah, I figured that. But do you know the printer name?
No. Can't you figure that out?
Me. Listen, I'm doing a meeting in a few. I need to finish up a couple things beforehand. If you can't get anyone to help you in the next hour from your area, bring me the computer name and I'll show you how to add it.
Can you come to my floor? That would be easier.
Me. Not for me. If you really want my help, make sure you bring the printer name with you. I'll be back for my meeting in an hour. Entitled mom walks off. My coworkers and I exchange glances and eye rolls and talk about how easy it is to follow the screenshots. I get to my meeting and forget all about Entitled mom until a friend IMs me. Hey, what did you do to Entitled mom? Me, not understanding the question's intent. I might be helping her add a printer if she can't figure it out by the end of the meeting. Any chance you can help her? Friend. But what did you do to her? She sounds upset and said you were really rude. Me. What? Does that even sound like me? I explain what happened. You can ask. Name of a friend we both know who is there. She was really pushy. I said I'd help her when I got out of this meeting if she couldn't figure it out. Can you help her? Friend. I'm on a call and I'm going to another meeting after. If I get out early, I'll try. Just thought you should know she's down here complaining about you. Fast forward to the end of the meeting. I get back to my desk to drop off my computer and then go to the break room to get some tea. I walk back to my desk with a friend. Entitled mom is waiting for me, looking irritated. Entitled mom, eyeing my cup of tea.
So, you had a meeting?
Me. Yes, then I got some tea. Were you able to figure it out?
No, that's why I'm back. Can you hurry up and add the printer? I need to get this printed for this afternoon.
Me. Hey, I'm offering to help you. I don't know you, and I hear you're complaining that I'm not being very helpful to your coworkers, and I don't even know you.
Who said that?
Do you want my help or not?
Fine, I got the name like you said.
Hands me a post-it. It read the words, HP LaserJet. I sigh. Listen, this isn't the name. Who's someone who sits near you that could run over to the room and check for us? I am her coworker, who promptly sends me a screenshot and says they offered to help her earlier, but Entitled Mom said I was going to. And I walk over to the printer room. I make her follow the directions and the screenshots herself, and it's set up in a couple of minutes. Entitled Mom.
See? Was that so hard?
Me. No, it really wasn't complicated at all. Next time, just give it a shot first, and then ask IT for help. Or lots of people in your area can do this, like the person we IM'd for the printer name.
Thanks. See you later.
Cheerfully goes off. I forgot all about it until the next day. I'm working and I hear a happy voice say,
Hi, it's me again. Thanks again for all your help yesterday.
Me, feeling annoyed, but relenting a bit because she sounds like she's being nice. Oh, you're welcome. Everything work okay?
Yeah, I got everything printed out just in time. Hey, I was telling my family about how you used to work on electronics, and my son has a question. Can you do a mod to his Xbox? This is where I make a giant error. I should have said no and just left it there. Instead, I say something like, it's been a long time. I think the last one I did was a Gen 2 Xbox while I was deployed. Oh, good. So you'll do it? Me, backpedaling hard. No, I can't. I don't even have the equipment to do that, and there are a lot of problems with making mods, like I could break the machine, and it would completely void the warranty. I said a bunch of other stuff too about why it was a bad idea. But my son really wants the mod, and everyone else wants too much money for it. They want like $50, and we'd have to buy the mod ourselves. Me. Well, yeah, it takes time, and the mod is more than $50. What you're paying for is a lot of skill and knowing how to solder. Again, I wouldn't know how to do any mods these days, and I don't have the equipment to do this anymore. It would cost you more to buy the equipment than to pay someone else. Even if I could do it, I'm not willing to. But he really wants it, and he doesn't want to pay that much. He says you can use the electronics lab at his school. At this point, one of my coworkers has had enough and tells her, listen, he doesn't want to do it, and he said no. Either pay someone who will, or tell your son he can't have it. Entitled mom looks shocked and leaves in a huff, saying, you don't have to be so rude about it. I figured that was the last I'd see of her, but no. My friend who works near her IMs me a little later and says she's going off. I find out who her manager is and set up a meeting with him a few days later. He shows up for the meeting with her in tow. We get into the room and he kicks it off. Thanks for taking the time to meet with us. I hope we can work out whatever conflict you're having. I've told Entitled Mom I want to stay unbiased, so I haven't heard her side yet. Can you tell me why you think you're having issues working with Entitled Mom? Me. What? Manager. Well, tell me your side of things, and then she can tell me hers, and then we can talk about it. This guy thinks he's here to resolve a conflict. Me. Well, she's being extremely rude. Entitled Mom, spluttering. Manager, looking frustrated but patient. Can we stick to the facts and avoid any kind of name-calling? Me. Okay, I'm just frustrated. She wants me to make a modification to her son's Xbox, and I'm not able to do it or willing to. Manager. I'm sorry. What do- Entitled Mom cuts in.
He wants me to spend money to hire someone else to do it. I already told him he could use the electronics lab at his school.
Manager. Entitled Mom, is this work-related? Entitled Mom.
Well, at first it was. He wouldn't help me install my printer. I finally got him to, and when I asked him to help my son, he refused. And one of the other people he works with was really mean about it. He made it personal.
Me leans back and smiles a little. Manager.
Your son?
Looks at me.
You're in supply chain, right?
Me.
Yes. Yes, I am.
Entitled Mom.
Yeah, he wants me to spend a bunch of money on my son's Xbox. My son even found a place for him to work on it. I was going to buy the thing he needs. He just has to install it.
Manager to her. Would you excuse us for a second? I'd like to talk to OP. Entitled Mom leaves, looking smug. Manager to me. I'm at the same level as the manager as far as responsibilities. Can you tell me what's going on? I ping my counterpart, who is there for both interactions. As she's entering, Entitled Mom calls out.
Make sure you tell him what really happened.
Manager.
I think I'm going to be really sorry. But what did happen?
We explain, and my coworker is way more heated than I am. I also refer him to my friend who works near them for the rest of the story and to show him my friend's IMs.
Manager. I'm so sorry. Do you want HR involved?
Me. Only if she keeps asking me to do this stuff. Also, next time if I ask for a meeting with you, don't add someone to the invite. Don't surprise me. We talk a bit more before he leaves, and he promises she'll only come to me if there's a work reason. Fast forward a month. She walks by my desk and says she's on her way to a meeting and says,
well, I just thought you should know we had to get our son a new PlayStation since you wouldn't help him with his Xbox.
Me. You weren't willing to pay someone who would do it for 50 bucks, so you spent hundreds on something different, and this is my fault?
Yeah. If you had just made the change, we wouldn't have had to.
I'm speechless. She walked off looking smug, and I emailed her manager and HR and haven't had to interact since. Apparently, she reserved a meeting room in my area just so she could walk by my area to say that. Now, she's not allowed to come to our area and has to work through her manager for anything to do with us. She's also been warned not to badmouth me or she'll lose her job. Edit. Wow, thank you, kind internet strangers. I'm glad there's a forum to share bizarre stories in.
I've enjoyed reading everyone else's, and I'm glad my story resonated. Something brought to my attention by a couple of commenters is the possibility that this lady wanted me. I had never considered that before, and shudder now. But it makes odd sense. I just IM'd my friend from the story, and he says she flirts a lot with people senior to her, often in very uncomfortable ways. Sad thing is that her husband is a successful person. It makes me wonder if he does the same thing. Shudders again. Have you ever had a coworker who kept bugging you to do things? If so, what did you do about it? Please let us know.
I don't see why he couldn't have just done it for her. The nerve of some people.
Entitled roommate has no idea I left. So I moved in with my coworker after working together for about 3 years. She's almost 60 and I'm 23 on the first of the month. I thought it was going to be calm and chill considering her age and how much of an introvert I am. Boy, was I completely wrong. I've never met anyone more entitled in my life, and I have a lot of stories I could have posted here, but this one I just had to. Just a few things that have happened less than a month of me being here. 1. While I was at work, she sent me a message asking to borrow $100 to go out and have fun. She has borrowed money from me in the past, and she gives it back in increments of 5s and 10s through a period of months. I told her I don't have $100 to just give to her, and she said, "What about 80? As if that makes it more doable. I told her no, and she said if I trusted her, I would give her my bank card so she could go take out the money she wanted from the bank and then bring my card back. No? I told her money doesn't leave my bank unless I'm taking it out, and she acted like I was only doing this so she couldn't go out and have a fun time. I lent her $12 that same morning for gas money. 2. A few hours after asking to borrow $100, she sent me another message telling me that I need to keep the curtains open always and make sure I tidy everything up before bed every night because that's how she likes her house. I told her that no, I will not be keeping the curtains open at night because it makes me feel unsafe, and also asked her if there was a reason for her to be saying I need to keep things clean. She responded back, telling me it's how she likes her curtains and to remember to keep them open during the day or before I ever leave the house. She also said there was no particular reason for her saying to keep things tidy. She was just telling me so I would know. I'm not a neat freak, but by no means have I ever left a mess for anyone else to find. I told her she was being ridiculous, and she told me it wasn't ridiculous and it's not a big deal to just listen to what she was saying and that I was stressing her out. 3. The same day, I was still at work. She told me she was going out anyway. Guess the $100 wasn't really essential, huh? And asked if I could bring her laundry up to her room for her. Mind you that this laundry is laundry that I did the night before, and I folded all of her clothes and put them on the couch for her. She didn't work the night I did the laundry or the next day, and she let it sit on the couch. I was in the middle of a 9-hour shift, in the middle of a rush when she asked that. I did not respond. It was very hard to come back after work and see it sitting on the couch and not throw it all back into the dryer. 4. She's been gone for days now. No idea where she is. But last night, after I got out of work, she sent me a message saying that this wasn't working out and she's going through too much in her life right now to have me adding to her stress. Denying her money, questioning her requests, asking if I'm a house guest, or paying half the rent stresses her out. I agreed and told her that this is too stressful for both of us and that I would leave before the end of the month. She freaked out. She told me that I'm not allowed to just leave and have to give her a notice and pay a fee of $81.25, the exact amount she said, just for the inconvenience. I never even signed anything when I moved in. We didn't even have a verbal agreement. It hasn't even been a full month. I told her that half of the cable/Wi-Fi bill, I got it for us, plus the $60 she owes me from 1 week alone should cover that mysterious fee. 5. The first week of me being there, she would walk in my room while I was sleeping, wake me up, and start talking about her day. Waking up to someone hovering over me is something that happened with a very bad ex numerous times, and every time she would do that, I would be terrified, and she knew I went through a situation like this. 6. If I left anything in the bathroom counter, she would move it to a drawer and tell me that my stuff needs to go into that drawer. 7. I left a brush on the table downstairs before leaving for work, and I come back to find it laying on the ground outside my bedroom door. 8. I've come back to find all of my wine coolers gone numerous times because she runs out of beer and she will drink whatever I have in the fridge. 9. She hasn't taken out the trash not once out of all of the time I've been there. 10. She would repeatedly ask me, "Why don't we talk anymore?" She loved to vent about herself. Then tells me she feels like she's walking on eggshells around me because I don't talk to her anymore. I like to be alone, especially after working 8-hour shifts days in a row. 11. When I tried explaining how I felt to her, she would get extremely defensive and act like I was purposely trying to stress her out. She couldn't say how stressed out her life had been the past few months enough, and anything I did that she didn't want me to was just so awful to her, and I was out to get her. 12. When I would leave the house, it's rare, but it happens, she would call me at least twice and send at least two messages within a two-hour period. I felt like I was being suffocated, and when I expressed this to her, she got really defensive and made me feel bad for saying anything at all. Not even a single month. Since she's been MIA for the past 3 days, the "this isn't working out" message happened last night, I started packing immediately after she sent that. It was almost like a saving grace. I've been debating on leaving since the second week, and that sealed it for me, and continued on in the morning. It took me all day, but I did it. And she still thinks I'm going to be there until the end of the month. She's going to walk into no cable / Wi-Fi, the same movies she's had for years, and a pile of laundry on the couch. She should feel lucky I left the dish soap, laundry detergent, paper towels, dish sponge, and two rolls of toilet paper, because I've been buying all of that too. I took all the groceries I bought that I still wanted and my ice cube trays. My mom couldn't stop laughing because she was so shocked she was like this. She had no idea. And Wednesday, she's helping me set up my room again. Feels good to be home. Update. She left a voicemail telling me I was to come back today because it's my day off and grab the rest of my stuff. I left a box in the shed because it's locked and she has the key to it. It's VHS tapes. And I will not come and go as I please. I'm not allowed there anymore, and that I left the room an absolute mess, and that she has to clean all day. I didn't want to hear her voice, so I sent her a message and told her I would be going on Wednesday, not today, and technically still have a week left. I also told her I hope she didn't do anything to that room, because I did in fact take a full-blown video of the room before I left that has the date. Her landlord is giving me back the security deposit on Wednesday, and that's why I'm going on Wednesday. She replied and said it was really wrong of me to decide to leave and I don't have a choice. I come today or Wednesday, that's final, so decide right now and that I'll learn as I get older that it's going to be so tough for me. I told her that I already said I'm going Wednesday, that I left because she said it wasn't working and I agreed, and why would I stay if we're both so uncomfortable? I told her a lot of things she did were so wrong, but I wasn't about to spend my day off arguing with her, so have a nice day. Bye bye. She says bye-bye to me whenever she sends a condescending message. Then I put her on ignore again. She won't be there Wednesday, but I'll make an update about what happens when I go. Update 2. A mutual coworker of ours called me. We used to all work together at a different job, and told me that she has been blowing her up and calling her multiple times in a row since I left to vent about how awful and how horrible of a person / roommate I am. The lies she is saying are outrageous, and I can't imagine all the people she must be calling and will continue to call until the wee hours of the morning. She calls people whenever she feels like it. And from what she said to her, I believe that she has trashed my room. Good thing I have the video, to try and make it so I don't get the deposit. I sent all the screenshots of what she's been messaging me to her. Some of them contradict what she told her, and she was laughing at the blatant lying she was doing. She also made it out to sound like I wasn't paying rent and just staying there free. And it turns out, whenever I didn't answer one of her messages while I was at work, or just in general, she would call her and yell about how disrespectful and rude I was, and how done she is with me, and what nerve I have to be living in her house and to not respond or listen to her. And apparently, she absolutely lost it on the phone about the curtain thing when I said no, but she didn't mention asking to borrow $100 or to take my bank card. The real kicker is that ex-roommate owes her $40. I am not ready for work tomorrow. Have you ever had a roommate that you just couldn't stand? If so, what did you do about it? Please let us know. Sounds like she needs to speak to her manager. Karen demands I load her dresser because I'm parked next to her. So today I'm at Costco getting my meds, minding my own business. A lady and her son bought one of the dressers that Costco is selling. Fine, all good. They actually look pretty good. Mom decides the two of them can get in the car and refuse to help despite the two of them basically being the living embodiment of Styx. I mean, anything's possible, right? We all made it out through the queue to get outside, and they're about 8 to 10 steps behind me. Mom and son are bickering because son knows she's not strong enough to lift aside. Mom won't have it. I get closer to my car, only to find a young family struggling with a 2-year-old refusing to go in its seat. Inconvenient, given it's 95 degrees before the heat reflecting properties of asphalt, but whatever, I'm not in a rush. Kids will be the monsters they will be. Mom and son try to lift the dresser to no dice and to my immense humor. I've had to deal with her at work before, and she isn't the nicest person. Sadly, she recognizes me at some point and demands I
get over here and help my son load this.
I pretended not to hear her and went about watching the kid just mess around with his dad trying to buckle him in.
10 for 10, would watch again with popcorn.
Mom decides to tap my shoulder to get my attention.
Cue, help my son load this dresser.
Again. No, as my answer isn't taken well and she had a freakout moment. Even so far to threaten to return the tree she bought from us because I was being rude. Good luck with that, lady. You and your son can't lift a 150-pound dresser. Good luck lifting that 800-pound autumn blaze maple now that it's had plenty of time to root in. I finally look at the son and see his obvious shame that his mom is acting like a 2-year-old, not wanting to go into the car seat. I agree to help the kid, so long as mom doesn't touch it because she will tip the box too much. Gotta keep in mind, I'm 6'2" with a 6'6" wingspan. I know, long arms. And a bit of a brute from shifting many 300 to 700-pound trees by hand. We lift the dresser into the truck bed without too much issue, despite the fact I took about all the weight. Mom then decided I need to follow them home to help offload the dresser. Heck no, lady. Heck no. It was big enough of an r/I-don't-work-here-lady moment to even load the thing, let alone ending up back at your house to offload it. The dad finally managed to get the baby buckled up, and I hopped in my car and drove off. Ended up that she called my job to complain that I was rude and not helpful. Sales staff know I'm off on Mondays, my only day off after all, and ask what it was about. Lady, I guess, decided to admit that she was trying to bully me into helping her, and it got laughed off. Can't wait to see what comes of this. Cheers, mad lads and mad lasses dealing with r/I-don't-work-here-lady issues. Edit 1. I'm aware I shouldn't have caved and helped her, but at the time it seemed like a good thing to help the kid with her. I have one of these entitled jerks as a stepmother. Kind of hard for me not to sympathize. I'll take the free mini vacation for $0, Alex. A little background. I took a position within my company that required a cross-country relocation from the West Coast to the East Coast, along with a change in corporate divisions. I knew as part of this deal I'd have to return to the West Coast once or twice a year, a total of maybe 6 to 8 days a year, to handle some integration things. So I packed up, left family and friends, and get happily settled in at the new job. A few months go by before the topic of a return trip to the West Coast pops up in a meeting. The guy that organizes our release schedule has pulled some dates out of nowhere for the trip. It's a Monday to Thursday. We coordinate with the customer and carve all this into granite. Let me take a quick detour here. The guy who maintains our schedule is Dean. Dean is paid a pricely sum to maintain an MS project schedule and do a couple other simple things. Dean doesn't seem willing to use the MS project features that allows you to import holidays into your schedules, so he once picked some arbitrary dates for a couple hardware techs to do work over what turned out to be Thanksgiving. It happens that this division of Mondo Corp doesn't pay us to travel on weekends, and Dean has me meeting the customer on Monday morning. I bring it up on our next staff meeting to confirm that, indeed, unlike my old division, they won't pay for weekend travel. My manager says, nope, no pay for weekend travel. I'm not happy I have to donate half a day on Sunday to the company. I have a little epiphany. I ask if Friday travel is authorized. My manager says, sure, why not? I ask again. I can fly back to the West Coast on Friday morning, get a rental car, stay 3 extra nights, and Mondo Corp will pay? The answer is still yes. I spent the weekend revisiting my favorite eating haunts, visiting family, visiting friends, and in general having a good time, all paid for by Mondo Corp. I get to work Monday morning with a nice tan and a bit of a hangover. Epilogue. Dean stopped scheduling things for Monday mornings. He now prefers we meet with customers on Tuesdays. Entitled lady won't pay me for cleaning her house. I've started cleaning an old lady's house for her a few times a week since she has a bad back and can't do very many things herself. She was very nice at first, showing me how to operate her very old vacuum, where everything is, etc. The first time cleaning her house took 2 hours. She paid me $50, and I was a happy teen. Well, after a few times, I got faster at cleaning. I'm able to finish cleaning in under an hour now. This is when entitled lady thinks that she can mess with me a little. I finished cleaning her house in about 45 minutes. This is the conversation. Me. I'm done cleaning for today. Entitled lady. Oh, good. You can call your mom to pick you up now. Me. May I please have my pay for today? You finished under 1 hour, so you don't get the money. Me. I don't think that's how it works. Entitled lady, getting a little annoyed. Well, maybe next time you should take your time cleaning. Me. Okay, I can do that next time, but may I please have my money for today? No. Now leave my house before I call the police for trespassing. I was completely shocked by what she said, and I left her house. I stood outside and called my mother to pick me up. When she got there, I told her what entitled lady had told me. My mother was furious. She ran up to the house and banged on the door. Entitled lady opens the door and the conversation occurs. Entitled lady, snarky attitude.
Can I help you?
Mom, already angry. Why didn't you pay my daughter?
She didn't work for an hour, so I don't have to pay her.
She cleaned your house for you. Now give me her pay. Now!
No. Leave my property now, or I'll call the police. Forget you!
My mother walked back over to the car and gave me some money from her wallet. Mom, here, you can at least have the money you earned. We left her property and got home. My mother was still furious about Entitled Lady and started yelling outside. Entitled Lady is our neighbor. Entitled Lady started yelling back at my mother. My mother yelled that I wouldn't be coming back to clean anytime soon. Entitled Lady didn't respond and my mother felt better then. This is only part 1. Part 2 will be posted later. Sorry for any spelling errors, I'm on my cell phone, and thank you so much for reading. Entitled Family Buys Their First Fish Tank. So I've taken up fish keeping as a hobby, and let me just tell you, those little guys are a lot of work. I'm in my local pet shop at least once every other week, to the point that they've gotten to know me pretty well. It's a chain store, but the staff at this place is really excellent, and I cannot heap enough praise upon them. They do a really good job of making sure to have at least one decently knowledgeable person there working in every section. Anyway, the other day I popped in to grab some fish food, and since I had room, maybe a couple of fish if they had anything interesting. It was semi-busy, and the fish section guy was busy helping a family of two parents and one very rambunctious girl who was running back and forth through the fish aisle. Every once in a while, the girl stopped to stare at one of the tanks and points out a fish she liked. Mommy's cooing, "Wow!" without looking up from the phone. Meanwhile, Dad came back over with a 15-gallon tank, which is relatively small for a tank, and basically all of the equipment, decorations, you name it. Everything you'd need to get started.
"Okay, sweetie," he said. "Ready to pick out some fishies?"
This stopped the fish guy in his tracks.
Are those fish for that tank you're buying?"
Dad enthusiastically replied.
"Yep, it's our first fish tank."
Okay, so I wouldn't expect this to be universal knowledge, but it is important to know if you plan on getting fish. It's a really bad idea to set up a fish tank and put the fish in on the same day. It's even worse if you put many fish in it simultaneously, because you need to give the tank time to settle first. Depending on the source, the water may have to be treated, as most species of fish are somewhat particular in the water conditions they can handle, and if you were including things like life plans, you need to give them time to make the changes to the water that they inevitably make. Otherwise, the stress and shock from unsuitable conditions or a rapid change in water quality can hurt the fish quite quickly. For a more scientific explanation of all this, look up aquarium cycling. Anyway, the fish guy politely explained this to the family and said that it's typically the store policy to not sell fish and a tank to customers on the same day. The tank should take about a week or two to cycle, and if there are any fish that they really want, they can buy them in advance and the store will hold them in a special tank until they're ready to be picked up. The little girl piped up with,
"Daddy, when can I get my fishy?"
And this guy went straight to,
"I'm sorry, sweetheart. This man is saying you can't have a fishy right now."
Immediately, this girl ran about 6 feet back, slammed her back up against the fish tanks, slid to the door, and started sobbing. Mommy rushed to the girl and immediately started with,
"Don't worry, Daddy will get your fishy."
Fish guy didn't really know how to handle this at this point, but lucky him that the manager was just happening to walk by.
"Is everything okay here?" he asked.
Dad replied with,
"Yeah, this guy won't sell us a fish."
The manager then asked, "Is it for that tank you're holding, sir?" Dad said, "Yes." And the manager began to give him the same exact explanation as the fish guy before. Dad cut in with,
"Yeah, I heard that spiel. Don't care."
The manager was trying to reiterate why it is such a bad idea to do this, and the dad finally said,
"Like I said, I don't care. You see that girl right there? I am more than happy to let that go on all day until you sell me some fish."
The manager sighed, looked at the fish guy and said, "Just give him the dang fish," and walked away for what I can only imagine was the most important cigarette of the day. The dad stood there looking all smug and announced,
"Okay, sweetie, you can get your fish."
And it was like a switch got flicked and the girl stopped immediately, like she had never had a tantrum in her life. As if it were not enough for them to get their way, this family proceeded to pick out a fish from virtually every tank. I wish I were joking. Without thinking twice, these people put together an abomination of a tank. You see, there are many kinds of fish. Some are big, some are small. Some are solitary, and some hang out in groups. Some like to nibble on store-bought flakes, and some delight in tearing the next nearest fish into fresh flakes. These are the things you must consider when stocking a tank with fish. These people did not consider that. Remotely. I'm talking like single specimens of fish that should be in a group. Some larger fish, like goldfish, which honestly need like 10 gallons apiece. Some catfish that are almost certainly not going to eat flakes from the surface. Basically, a whole bunch of fish that should not be together and not crammed into 15 gallons of water. But friends, there is at least some assurance that these people will have a learning experience. You see, the very last fish they grabbed was what the father called the biggest goldfish I've ever seen. Fish guy tried to explain, but by that point they had completely tuned him out. Look, his name is Oscar, like Oscar the Grouch. Heh, Grouch, that's putting it lightly. Because you see, Oscar was not a goldfish. Oscar was an Oscar, a type of cichlid. They are territorial as heck. And this guy was destined for a 15-gallon tank of many much smaller fish. So they went off to pay. They left a decent number of zebrafish, so I ended up asking for those. I told the guy, and don't worry, my tank cycled and is well established. He just put his head down and said, those idiots. I replied, I feel bad for the fish though. He said that when they inevitably come back for a refund, they'll have a hard time with it when the receipt shows both the tank and the fish. Anyway, if Oscar survived the water conditions, I'm sure they're having a National Geographic moment right now. I'll try to remember to follow up if the same guy is working next time I go in. He's there frequently, so am I. I should probably learn his name. I'm bad with that kind of stuff. Watch this video next, you will love it.
And join as a channel member today and we'll give you a special shout out on a next video. And to have us make any kind of video you'd like us to, come visit us on Fiverr, link pinned in the comments below.